was perceived by ordinary people across India and in the world. I'll just give you an illustration from my first research in Kumar, which gives you a sense of how ordinary Indians who had never seen Gandhi, you know, not just people like Ambedkar and Jinnah or Nehru and Patel, ordinary Indians. So in Kumar, this is also a story that involves administration or misuse of administration as it happens. You know, in those of you who have been to Uttarakhand know how difficult, I mean, this we're talking about the 1920s when there were no roads. And the colonial officials, the forest officials and the civil service officials had to go on tours. And there was an old custom whereby they had to take, you know, they had to carry provisions. The peasants had to give what is called kuli bega. They were obliged by law to carry the loads of the officials and provide them milk and chicken and whatever else they wanted. And there was a movement when Gandhi started his non-cooperation movement of 1920-21. The Uttarakhandi nationalists, including Govind Ballabh Pant, started a movement. The peasants on their own said, we will not carry these loads of these forest officials and these district officials, and we will join this we will have our own interpretation of non-violence. No, the lawyer said we won't go to court. These peasants said we will not do kuli bega. And there was a major struggle which was successful finally to end it. And the biggest public meeting was held during, there's a big fair during Sankranti in a place called Bageshwar in Kumaon. And there was a big fair there. And there was a local peasant leader called Badridhar Pandey, who's addressing this big crowd, saying, throw down your loads. If a forest officer comes, don't carry his stuff. Don't, if a the district magistrate comes and says, humko do, don't give him. And then he's sort of inspiring them to protest. And then he says, in the middle of the speech, he says, he would have said it in Kumaoni, but the transcription is in English in the colonial record. He says, God has sent his, this is Badridhar Pandey, a peasant leader, telling the peasants to inspire them in their struggle against the British. He says, God has sent Gandhi. God has sent Gandhi in the form of a baniya to fight a baniya government. All right. Now, you go to Assam and you ask them, someone asks, you know, a journalist asks the president of Assam, what is Swaraj for you? He says, Swaraj is not paying taxes. Not, you know, freedom from the British and so on. So the perceptions of Gandhi among peasants, among workers and overseas. You know, Lord Willingdon, whom I quoted as being upset that the Americans admire Gandhi. I mean, the Americans venerated Gandhi. They've never seen Gandhi. Gandhi never went to America. Right? This is an age of, you know, not even the radio hasn't been invented. The telegraph has barely come. And yet he is known all over. In my book, I have a lovely ad which I reproduce. So you can have this back button. I'll send it later. See, in my book, there's a lovely ad I reproduce, which is from the New York Times in 1932. Now, just think, 1932, Gandhi has not been to America. The New York Times carries an ad. The ad is for a clothing store in Broadway. And the ad has four men who are Wall Street bankers sitting on a railway station, waiting for a suburban train. And the ad is urging them to buy good suits from this tailor in Broadway. And the first line says, Gandhi does not need to read this ad because he wears nothing. That's his choice. But those of you who want to be dressed properly, you know, this is the seven reasons why you should buy our suits. Now it's amazing. From the peasant in Garhwal who says ki Gandhi has been sent as a baniya to find a baniya government, to advertisements in America which, you know, innovatively use the fact of Gandhi not you wearing suits to promote their own suits. I have tried to reconstruct this range of interest in Gandhi. And last, and then I'll end here. The last thing that this book does is, it deals with his campaigns, his critics, his perceptions, and his colleagues. All those who worked with him in the freedom struggle. And, you know, I've dealt, of course, there are many extraordinary people with Gandhi. And all of them have very intense, complicated relations with him. And, someone asked me on my way in, where I'm working on the book. Actually, I'm taking a break now, but one day I might want to write a book on Gandhi's 12 apostles. who include, of course, Nehru, Patel, Rajaji, Acharya Kriplani, Bose, Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay from our state, the most extraordinary female nationalist of the time, and so on. And all of them figure in my book, you know, in different ways, you know, how, where they met Gandhi first, how they came attached to him, where they followed him, where they disagreed with him. You know, for example, Bose, you'll see quite a lot about Bose, and some of it will surprise you, or at least surprise the Bengalis in this room, maybe some of the others too. So I describe really the people who made the freedom movement and who made Gandhi. Gandhi's three greatest colleagues were Rajaji, Patel, and, you know, with no disrespect to some of the others, the three who were closest to him and who in many ways understood him most intimately were Patel, Rajaji, and Nehru. Now, in Rajaji's papers, which are in the Nehru Museum, I found a letter written to Rajaji by just an unknown Tamil in the 1950s, after Gandhiji had died. And here is this unknown Tamil writing to Rajaji saying that you, Patel, and you, Sardar and Panditji, were, and he said, this letter says, so you, that is Rajaji, Patel and Nehru, were the head, heart and hand of Gandhiji. Now this is just an unknown Tamil. What a beautiful image. You know, Rajaji was the head. He was the one you'll see in this book who warned Gandhi against the most extreme and stupid steps he was going to take. And that's why Rajaji called, Gandhi called Rajaji the conscience, keeper of my conscience. So Rajaji was the head. Jawaharlal was the heart, who had an emotional understanding of Gandhi's pluralism, and took it forward. And Sardar was the hand, the organizer, who organized all the movements, who made the Congress an All India organization, and so on and so forth. It's a beautiful image. Rajaji, Patel, and Nehru were the head, the heart, and the hand of Gandhi. But while it's a very evocative line, which at least the older people in this room who have some memories of the three people I've talked about, you know, it resonate with them. There was someone who was even more important to Gandhi than him. This was Mahadev Desai, whom I've already mentioned. Mahadev was simultaneously the head, heart, and hand of Gandhi. You know, he was someone who, unlike Nehru, was a Gujarati. So he had a direct connect with the cultural world that made Gandhi. He was someone who, unlike Sardar Patel, was an internationalist, who a cosmopolitan, who had a vision of the world. You know, if Hitler came to power or the Bolshevik Revolution succeeded, Mahadev would tell Gandhi what it meant, because he had read Lenin and read Mein Kampf and had a complex understanding of politics. And he was with Gandhi from 1917 till 1942, and he was absolutely the most important person in Gandhi's life, and yet he has been forgotten. We remember Nehru, we remember Patel, we remember Rajaji, we remember Kamala Devi, Azad, Bose, Kriplani, but he's been forgotten. He's been forgotten because he wrote himself out of the narrative. And I tried in my book, through the diversity of sources I've used, to give Mahadev Desai the central place he deserves in the life of Gandhi and in the life of the freedom struggle. And when he had this breakdown in 1938, Gandhi told him to take a holiday. And he said, in his letter to Mahadev, urging him to take a holiday, he said, "Shall we say you have a mania for work? Don't you know that if you were to be disabled, I would be a bird without wings? If you became bedridden," this is Gandhi writing to Mahadev, "if you became bedridden, I would have to wind up 3/4 of my activities." Now that's how important Mahadev was in Gandhi's life, and in my book you'll find many more details about this. But I'm going to end my presentation with a verse Gandhi wrote in the same year, 1938, when Gandhi wrote this letter to Mahadev. In 1938, Gandhi and Mahadev had a huge falling out, which almost left to Mahadev resigning, and I'll leave the details of that for the book. But he wrote, Mahadev, when he decided to withdraw his resignation, wrote an account of his dispute with Gandhiji. It was a philosophical political dispute, not a petty personal dispute. He wrote an account in the journal Harijan about why he almost resigned and why he withdrew the resignation. And that dispute ended with this immortal quatrain. And I'm going to read out the quatrain to you. To live with the saints in heaven is a bliss and a glory. To live with the saints in heaven is a bliss and a glory. But to live with a saint on earth is a different story. Thank you.
Poet also, sir, in a way you were quoting. Ladies and gentlemen, I will be taking a couple of questions first. I would request anybody from the audience to please put up a hand and introduce yourself. I would like ACS Mr. Mahendra Jain to start, sir. Then I'll come to you, sir. Mahendra Jain is the additional Chief Secretary, Urban Development Department.
Is there a mic going on?
Yeah, yes. Oh, mic
audible.
No, I know, it's coming.
On this side.
I like to have unquestioned faith in his greatness. But when his critics criticize him for his, say, things like his relative failure as a father or as a husband, or his controversial role in the partition, or even his, things like that, or his personal preferences with regard to his sexuality and so on, one kind of finds it difficult to, or one has to stretch one's arguments to defend him.
Yeah.
So do you also face this dilemma?
Yeah.
And how do you deal with it?
So, you know, that's a very good question. It requires a slightly long answer. This book, you know, most people, Indians, not foreigners, this book is published abroad also, but Indians who read this book, knowing the basic facts about Gandhiji's life, they will end it. I'm already getting responses, learning a lot more. But some people's overall reaction after reading this book will be, I admire him even more than I began. And others will be, I dislike him even more than when I began. All right. So you can't, this book tells you everything. It suppresses nothing. Oh, obviously, broadly, it's a sympathetic portrait. But the failures you allude to, I've talked about. So his failures as a father, as a husband, his obsession with celibacy, and his imposition of it on his grandniece. And I argue that if Mahadev had been alive, he would have told him, "Tu to pagal ho, ye mat karo," and to talk him out of it. Right? But one aspect of what you said, because there are many criticisms we made of Gandhi, they're fair. One aspect of what you said at the end is unfair, though it is very common among Indians, especially young Indians, this business of partition. Gandhi was not responsible for partition, firstly. Secondly, no human being did more to heal the wounds of partition than Gandhi. Partition is a and I come to a third point also, I mean, which is relevant particularly from the point of administration. The roots of partition go back to the separate electorates granted by the British in 1906. Those sowed the seeds of partition. There were various times in the 20s and 30s where Hindus and Muslims possibly could have got together, but by the time the war broke out, it was impossible. And partition was something which neither Jinnah, nor Gandhi, nor Nehru could have stopped, or Patel could have stopped. It could have been done in a different way, with less loss of life. The British are responsible for that. They didn't take adequate precautions. But once partition happened, think of a 78-year-old man who is walking through the villages of Bengal. Think of a 78-year-old man who's on fast. I was in Calcutta last week and I went to the Haidari mansion where he went on fast. And who brought peace to a city where 5,000 army men could not bring peace to Punjab. Think of a man who made sure that the Muslims of Delhi, that great Muslim city, would still at least have some Muslims in it. And what was Gandhi going to do when Godse shot him? He was going to go, if he had another 2 weeks to live, he was going across the border to safeguard the rights of Hindus and Sikhs in Pakistan. So look at his extraordinary sacrifice. I mean, think of who could have done more to heal the wounds of partition. The last point, and this is very, very important for those who are nostalgic about United India. The only way partition could have been stalled was through the Cabinet Mission Plan of 1946. And the Cabinet Mission Plan of India, under that, the princely states were semi-autonomous. The provinces would secede, and the princely states were semi-autonomous. Your name is Mahendra Jain. I presume you are not a Kannadiga Jain. You are a Kannadiga Jain. Okay, apologies. But there are people from North India. There's a Pandey here somewhere I met before. Okay, there's a Pandey here. Apologies. Are you from somewhere near Mudibitri?
No,
because Mudibitri is a favorite child of mine. Okay, Mr. Pandey here or somebody else. No, If the cabinet mission plan had been accepted, you could not have been in the Karnataka cadre, because Hyderabad would be in a quasi-independent republic. So very simple, right? So those who are nostalgic for a united India, young people who are confused, or not like you, but other people, you know, would know this. So I think many of the other criticisms of Gandhi, his obsession with celibacy, his imposition of celibacy on his fellows, why should Jayaprakash Narayan and Verrier Elvin and Kripalani be celibate? He can be celibate, right? So there's some of them you can't defend. But on partition, I would say there's a great deal of misinformation. Both in this book and in India After Gandhi, I try and tackle that misinformation.
Yeah.
Sir, please.
I must confess that I read your book.
Yeah.
About 3 weeks back, I got it.
Yeah.
And I finished the book 4 or 5 days ago.
Yeah.
And it reads like a thriller.
Thank you.
Finish it in one kind of a sitting, continuously. Not one sitting, in about 20 days.
Yes, thank you, sir. Yeah.
Now, I also read about Gandhi for a long time, because in our time, that in 60s, my experiments with truth was a compulsory reading for us. So I've been reading about Gandhi for a long time, for a great man that he was, and for, as you said, he has written about or spoke about everything, almost everything under the sun. Many times inconsistencies are also there. I want to raise two specific points. One is about this Ambedkar thing that you mentioned.
Yeah.
The kind of arguments between Ambedkar and him on, especially on the caste question. Ambedkar wrote that his undelivered speech, that annihilation of caste.
Yeah.
To which Gandhi had replied. This is quoted in your book. I just will read just two lines. This is what Gandhi says. I believe that the caste has saved Hinduism from disintegration. There appears to be no valid reason for ending the system because of its abuse. The spirit of democracy, which is fast spreading through India and the rest of the world, will without a shadow of doubt purge the institution of the idea of predominance and subordination. This is what Gandhi had said. You have quoted in your this is in chapter 6. Anyway, to which, of course, Ambedkar was a virulent kind of a person. He won't keep quiet. So what he said was this. He criticized that Mahatma is playing a double role of a Mahatma and a politician. And this is what he said, which is also quoted in your book. That is chapter 23, From Rebels to Rulers.
Ah.
It says like this. He said this, Ambedkar. The reason, somewhat hitting below the belt, the reason why the Mahatma is always supporting caste and Varna is because he is afraid that if he opposed them, he will lose his place in politics. Now, this is what
Ambedkar
says. It may not be quite true, but this is what he had said. But the point I make on this is, during the past 7 decades, Mahatma Gandhi's, the Mahatma's prediction or desire or the ideal that democracy will succeed in India and all these things will go behind, I mean, will disappear, has not proved to be
correct
at all.
Yeah.
And we have, as you yourself have said there, somewhere else, not in this book, they have got this election-only democracy, with the resort-friendly democracy, all kinds of things we have got.
Yeah.
So the point about this is, what about the caste question, which while he was all for abolition, abolition of untouchability, but when it came to caste, he was not quite agreeing with Ambedkar. The second point I want to mention is this. This is about the glorification of village.
Yeah.
In fact, in your book, Prelude to Partition, that is chapter 33, you have mentioned this in some detail. To quote again Gandhi, in his letter to Nehru, he says, if India and the true India, the world, is to achieve real freedom, then sooner or later we will have to go and live in the villages, in huts, not palaces. And then again he writes in 1946 in an article called entitled Pyramid versus the Oceanic Circle. Every village will be a republic and should be self-sustained and capable of managing its affairs, even to the extent of defending itself against the whole world. The villagers should be ready even to perish for the village. This is actually quoted in Annihilation of Caste in Ambedkar's book. The point I'm making is this. this village glorification or glorification of the village.
Self-sufficiency.
Self-sufficiency, all these things, sir. I'd say we are now, I mean, just 1 minute only I'll take, I'll finish. India has got 5,91,000 villages. 56% of them have got people each living less than 1,000 in each of these villages. There's tremendous unemployment there, malnutrition, all kinds of problems are there. Now, the contrast between Gandhi and this China, its chairman, so they have the same kind of a problem of what to do for bringing prosperity to these villages.
Right.
Which was a land of villages. So what they did was something else. They didn't go for the villages and then improving every village. They found it impossible to do that. So they had this commune centers or the capitals of the communes, and then later on the TVs, that is the town and village committees, and then the town committees, and then now they are developing, they are developing in the past 5 years some 200 cities of more than 1 million.
Yeah.
So all of them have got education and the health unlike most
right.
of our villages.
Right. Yeah.
So I
cut
the last sentence. The point is, this village glorification which you have followed unconsciously or consciously in the planning commission and even now, whether these things have done some harm to India rather than good. Thank you.
Is opposed even to intermixing. In his ashram everyone can eat and mix and so on. But then Narayana Guru radicalized him before Ambedkar and the temple entry movement starts. Then he is responding to Ambedkar's challenge, and in fact, in the last year, from the late 1930s, he's not even defending caste.